lot of different data providers, so you kind of sit in the middle of different data standpoints, things like that. You know, we're in a position right now in our industry with a lot of change and a lot of shifting around strategies, ways to contact people. I know on the last panel we were talking about different channels, digitizing the way you can reach a consumer via texting or emails, things like that. We're in a position where we need to adjust to a lot of new regulation rules coming down the pipeline, problems we have to deal with, and ways that we need to contact our customers and consumers. And with that aspect in mind, I think that alternative data plays a very big role in the future and where we're going and how we can get to the customer easier, quicker, and more efficiently. So in that stance, welcome to the alternative data panel and best practices, how to use it, when to use it, things along those lines. So I'll go ahead and let you guys introduce yourself. We have some pretty great people up here on the panel. So Jeremiah, if you want to start.
Sure. Yeah, I'm Jeremiah Wheeler. I'm the Executive Vice President and General Manager of FinTech at Viewering Data. And I've been with the company for 7 years now, in the industry for almost 15. And glad to be here. Thanks for coming out.
Thanks. I'm Randy Bob with Factor Trust. I'm Vice President of Auto Finance Sales at Factor Trust. And yesterday, Factor Trust was acquired by TransUnion. That was big news. So Factor Trust is now part of the TransUnion family. And I've been in this information and data services space for over 20 years. Previously, Experian, LexisNexis, and FICO.
I'm Chris Byrne. I'm a director of sales with Auto Finance for Carfax. Have been with Carfax for less than a year. My background is in the auto lending space, GMAC. I'm dating myself a bit now, since they're no longer around. Before Credit Primus, Bank of America's dealer services, and SunTrust dealer services. Enjoy being here and appreciate you guys coming out.
Thank you, John. I don't know if you need the mic or not, but thank you, John, Jerry, for having us here. My name is Shane Krapko with Trust Science, and what we're doing is we're looking at all the unstructured data that's available.
Okay, so Shane, I'll kind of start with you. You threw a number at me yesterday saying that out of all the data out there, 95% of it's unstructured data. So I know what you guys are doing a little bit is doing internet searches, scraping the internet for data that you can't necessarily pull or purchase from a provider, so to say. You want to talk a little bit about what you're doing and how it relates back to pulling data into the collection servicing space?
Sure, yep. We're looking at everything that is available on a person out there. So the unstructured data can come in the form of blogs or tweets or Facebook posts and also just regular public records and or the dark web. And we're looking at all that information. There's lots of noise in there. All the structured data, the stuff you get from TransUnion, Factor Trust, Experian, that data amounts to about 5% of the structured data that's out, of all the data that's out there, structured data is about 5%. Unstructured is 95%. And we're making sense of that unstructured data. To be sure, there's lots of noise in there, lots of, if you will, garbage, but there's lots of good nuggets, and we're sifting through that finding those nuggets.
You're talking about pulling phone numbers, addresses, contact information off of anything, Facebook, Twitter. I think you even mentioned Tinder at one point, right? You're pulling information off Tinder.
Yep. Anywhere where there's information about people, we will go there. So it's not just phone numbers that we're looking for. It might be, we are a machine learning, artificial intelligence platform. And those are buzzwords that are being thrown around. Everybody throws them around. We throw them around too. It's a new area, and it's a continuum. It'll only but get better. Just like Netflix 10 years ago was something, and today it's something better, and so on. We will get better. All the AI and machine learning providers will get better over time. It may get to where if a person, we might identify based on the Facebook post, Twitter feeds and so on, that we will find that somebody wearing red suspenders and blue socks is going to be very good credit risk. Or people who have pictures of them carrying a chihuahua in their Facebook post, they might be real good credit risk. Don't know. The machine will figure that out.
Right. Well, so kind of get into how that data is related back to how it's being used, right? So instead of going out and going into these sites where there's so much risk in getting into Facebook, and lenders don't want their collectors accessing all these different websites, where's the real benefit to pulling that information in? And are you seeing the benefit being streamlined as gathering it, or is it more the actual data itself? So all these people want the data, but they don't want to get the data. So is that really where you see it playing a role in the servicing side of the collections? Is that something that your predominant space is now, or is that something you're just getting into?
Yeah, on the whole life cycle of a loan, from marketing to decisioning to servicing to then skip tracing the ones that go bad, we play a role in all of that whole life cycle. I think the biggest value is in the decisioning. And it is, like you say, in collecting that and making sense of it. There's lots of data out there, and finding the nuggets that relate to creditworthiness.
So Jeremiah, DRN, you guys are doing a lot of stuff with location data. I think the one thing we've seen over the past is that lenders, especially on the conservative side, are shifting from more of a contact approach to a location data approach. Kind of want to talk about that, maybe what you're seeing and maybe why you're seeing lenders move to such a location data strategy on the data side.
Yeah, well, and I think it's, you know, in auto finance, it just makes sense, right? Because you're looking for an asset typically. You're always looking for an individual in the collections and recovery space. So typically, you know, people are within a very close proximity of their car 90%+ of their life. So typically you find the car, you find the customer. And so with us collecting in over, you know, 386 markets, 150 million sightings a month, it's a big data set that you can use to start really doing some predictive analytics for risk associated to where the person's garaging their car for insurance purposes, or where the person says that they are on your account records versus where we know they are. So when you look at it earlier and earlier in your collection cycles, you can not run it through the same mill that you're used to running it through and see if you can change your curves of loss, to improve that, to invest more money in your marketing and originations and things of that nature. So we're kind of going down that path, but I think, you know, even more important than DRN and what DRN is doing is with the advance of data and analytics and, you know, the trust science and what they're doing. I mean, at this point in time, obviously, it's not FCRA compliant. You know, you couldn't use it for certain things, but yeah, it needs to be, because there's so many underbanked customers in the country that, you know, everyone needs access to credit in some way, shape, or form. So the better we can make the data keep up with the laws and the legislation is really important. So I think that takes a little bit of everyone getting involved and, you know, pushing legislators to, you know, make laws that make sense for the betterment of our economy and our industry. So, you know, we worked really hard with a number of very large data providers and data companies in the state of California to enact a law specifically related to data and how we use it and what's permissible and what's not permissible, so that we could kind of start to set the precedence of getting laws like that put in place that protect the data companies, but also protect the consumers, and everyone's happy, and, you know, we can move the ball forward. I think that's a problem that we see in our industry and, you know, in the world today, is that technology is developing at such a rapid pace right now that, you know, the laws and the legislation doesn't keep up with it. Therefore, everyone suffers. And so that's why the majority of these, you know, events are focused on legislation, focused on compliance, and how much it's costing everybody to try to keep up with them who they're behind. So I think it's important to keep that in the back of our minds and how we approach each association that legislates on our behalf. I'm a very big supporter of all those, so that's kind of the point I wanted to make.
Yeah, I agree 100%, thank you. Randy, from Factor Trust, first of all, congratulations on that position.
Thanks, Jerry.
Good stuff. Kind of help us all better understand a little bit about your data source in particular. You guys are alternative credit data, so you're not your, you probably speak a little bit than I could, so I want to kind of elaborate on that a little bit, kind of what you guys have to offer.
Sure, alternative data and alternative credit data is a popular buzzword these days. So alternative credit data is what Factor Trust is all about. And it's data we collect directly from other alternative lenders. So back in 2005, 2006, we started working with short-term lenders, payday lenders, rent-to-own installments. So it's really non-traditional lenders, alternative lenders that we work with. And so we collect data directly from these lenders in real time. So again, we built a unique reporting gateway for these lenders to report to us. Traditionally, these lenders have never reported to the traditional bureaus because of that reporting structure and the payment cycle. It's weekly payments, and their data really didn't fit into the traditional Metro 2 format for Experian, Equifax, or TransUnion. So we built this database, a real-time reporting gateway for these alternative lenders to report their data to us. So these short-term lenders, payday lenders, are sending us data about a consumer that you typically would not find in a traditional bureau. And so that data would be about their trade line, so performance about the trade line, the short-term loan, but they also send us employment, income, bank account data, and contact data. So Factor Trust is a credit reporting agency, and we do offer FCRA decisioning products. So you can decline or take adverse action with our data at different points of that risk management life cycle with the consumer. And that consumer can come to Factor Trust, dispute their Factor Trust information, get a copy of their Factor Trust credit report. And so alternative data, again, when you look at it, I would recommend you guys to look at the source of the data, where is it coming from, the coverage, and obviously how often is that reported. So again, we get our data real time from these lenders. Anytime they have a new trade line or an update on the trade line from a short-term loan, installment loan, rent to own, a new application, that data comes to Factor Trust in real time. So always try to understand the source of the data, the coverage, and how timely is it reported. And then obviously, is it adverse action? Is it FCRA, non-FCRA? At Factor Trust, we see that if someone's in our database, we are, because we're dealing with these alternative lenders, we are a non-prime, subprime database. I mean, that's who these consumers are. So we've found over the years of our existence that if a consumer is in our database, they're twice as likely to go bad if they're not. So a 2x higher default rate if they're in our database versus if they're not. So from your standpoint, that helps you at a credit decisioning standpoint, but also from a servicing collection standpoint. You can obviously do some treatment strategies. If someone's in our database, a little bit higher risk, more of a red flag. So your treatment strategy from a servicing collection or account management standpoint might be a little different than if they're not in our database. And so again, we've got applications across the life cycle. And the other thing that I'll mention from a servicing collection standpoint is that this data typically has high value, meaning that consumer that's going to that payday short-term loan lender, they're typically an habitual user of that product. So they've learned that these payday lenders, short-term lenders, are very stringent on contact data and employment data, income data. The first time they lie, they don't get the loan. So that data is typically, that's provided to that lender, it has high quality from a contact standpoint. So we can pick up the cell phone, the address, the email, new employment, new income, new bank account data that can help you. Last thing I'll mention, and I'll turn it over to Chris, is that it is a niche database, so it's supplemental to your other data sources. We don't replace Experian, Equifax, TransUnion. We're not part of TransUnion, but we're supplemental to those data sources. Typically, in subprime auto, our hit rate of someone being in our database is 35 to 50%. So you're not gonna see 100% hit rate, but when you do see a hit, it's high value. If you don't see a hit, there's value there too. You know they're typically less risky. But that's probably a long-winded overview, but I appreciate it, Jared.
Yeah, and so I think a big part of that too is the type of people that go delinquent, go into collections, they're more likely to be in your database just because of the position they're in. So on the return that you guys are seeing is probably valuable information to what you're looking for. So thanks for that. Chris, vehicle history data is a very useful data source throughout a bunch of different positions in the life cycle of an account. You want to touch on how it can be used in maybe collections and originations and all throughout the process?
Yeah, it's really interesting because unlike these guys, we don't get involved in PII at all. We are purely on the VINs. So we don't get involved with the owner, the people, the anything from an origination standpoint all the way through collections. the value of our data is purely the volume. We've got over 19 billion records. We added a billion records in the last 6 months, and when we first started, it took us 12 years to get a billion records. So we're adding tons of volume over time. One of the big things, obviously, is the value of the vehicle. We've shown statistically that if you have a similar creditworthy customer and you have good collateral and bad collateral, the poor collateral with exactly the same credit customer is going to perform worse. You can have bigger losses, you can have bigger delinquency, and bigger repos. So the value of the collateral is a huge indicator at the beginning of the origination process of the repayment. Also, obviously with the storms, I think everybody's aware of the storms, we found a little over a week after the storms, after Harvey, there was a car left Houston, somebody dried it out, cleansed it, whatever, and we found it in Montana a little over a week later. So these cars are all over the country. And the Texas DMV, our insurance folks, worked with them, and evidently the folks on our insurance team met with folks in Texas, and they were saying it's probably going to be 6 to 8 months behind. So if we're waiting on branded titles to see if the car's flooded or not, you're not going to find it immediately. We find it immediately. We have contacts with all the insurance companies, service centers, repair shops, et cetera, et cetera. It's that private data, which is approximately 70% of our database. 30% is public, 70% is proprietary, and that's where we're finding all these flooded vehicles right now. So that's on the origination side. On the collection side, folks are using it first and foremost to prioritize. We had an example of a car that folks were looking for in Arizona, customers in Arizona. Turned out it was in a collision center, a burnout shell in Idaho. Stopped looking for it. Place a lien on the customer and move on down the road. It's not worth even bringing that car back. So prioritization is a huge, huge part of it. And the second is to locate. Like I said, the proprietary data, the repair shops, the minor keys, the oil change places, all that good stuff. You know, several examples of Joe Smith is your borrower in Dallas, and Sally Jones just had the oil changed in Denver. We don't supply you that Sally Jones got the oil changed. We supply you with the VIN number, and the location, the phone number of that service center, and oftentimes what lenders tell us they do is they'll call the service center and say, yes, we're a lien holder on that vehicle, we're keeping maintenance records on our collateral, would you please send me the invoice for that so we can update our records on the collateral. Next thing you know, they get a phone number, an address, and a name of somebody completely different than their customer. The customer's not calling back, they don't have a car anymore. So very useful in finding locating areas of vehicles. Can be a completely different place than you're looking for. So those are from a 3,000 foot level, probably the big two ways.
So I think one thing you touched on, Randy, was factor trust and alternative credit data not necessarily being a replacement of data, but how they complement all the other different data sources. So when you guys put all your different data together with the Experian, Equifax, and TLOs, the mainstream, so to say, data providers, how do you guys see yourselves working with them in a place to really improve contact to, or location with the customer?
Yeah, and obviously being part of TransUnion now, that's a different story. TransUnion, just a quick overview on TransUnion, they've been aggressive in the alternative data space. L2C was an acquisition, CLO was an acquisition, eBureau was an acquisition. And so, but I know Paul's here from Experian. Experian's been active on alternative data as well. So the data sources blend very well together because you obviously, from a lender perspective, you're looking for as much information you can get on that consumer. And also you're looking for as much information you can get on the collateral. So it just follows, today's world around big data. But from an alternative versus traditional, they usually combine well because, again, our data is data that typically has not made it to a traditional credit bureau, mainly because the lender, the source of the data. And so that, because the source of the data fits well and complements well, at Factor Trust, we've
we've worked with other data sources. We've worked with LexisNexis in the past, and I've worked at LexisNexis in my past, and that public record is typically a good complement to alternative credit data as well, because public record can help you with obviously the addresses, the phone numbers, the emails, some of the tax liens, bankruptcies, judgments. That fits very well with obviously trade line data that you're not seeing today on a traditional bureau. So we've definitely seen a nice correlation and collaboration between the data sources. And I think from your perspective, from a lender perspective, how do we provide all this data to you in a usable format? And so I know that in the previous session, that was a topic of conversation. So that's a question you should always ask your data provider. It's common sense. How can I utilize your data? But scores, obviously, a mid-sized, smaller lender will look at a score. We've, at Factor Trust, we've built blended scores that take LexisNexis data, Factor Trust data, FIS data is another source we've used. That's additional bank account data. So that's something I would recommend to you guys as a lender, is try to understand the different sources and can it blend into a score that's very usable for your application. You can do some testing on that to see how that score could segment your portfolio. There's also attributes. Are you more sophisticated where you want to dig deeper into the data and look at attributes? Or do you want to look at a full Factor Trust type score? So again, the data blends very well together, traditional, alternative. And within alternative, you've got non-FCRA and FCRA. So I would encourage you guys to look at all those different parts of the data and see what kind of application and usability it has in your business.
All right. Shane, how would you see internet scraping and that data source play into other providers and how they can collaborate and ultimately become a more effective method?
Yeah, it's an augmentation. The data is out there, and so work with different providers to different scoring companies and augment what they're doing.
Right. This is kind of go down the line and see if you guys can answer. Where do you see your specific LPR location, alternate data vehicle history scraping, where do you see it playing the most valuable role moving into the 2018 and further in the entire life cycle of an account? I mean, going from, where do you see your data source becoming most valuable to a lender?
Well, for me, it's, and for DRN, it's really, it's continuously growing and moving, I think, earlier in cycle. I mean, we started, 7 or 8 years ago, working on the oldest accounts that have charged off for, post 180 days plus, and we managed to work our way down to the cycle because the more data and analytics that you can get earlier, the risk indicators you can create, the collateral, the days to recover you can cut in half. So I think it's just going to be an evolution of continuous process improvement within, each lender that we work with, as well as, the important thing too is, integration partners and, the things that we're doing with MasterQ and RDN and MBSI and, all of our partners that we work with. We want lenders to have access to actionable data earlier and earlier in cycles. So, it will continuously evolve and, we'll be able to track that and show which data sets, which credit categories or which customer behavioral score categories are creating the most, trouble to find, how many hits are we getting, in certain areas. We're looking at all those things, but at the end of the day, it's about, continuously evolving our processes to be efficient internally and see which data sets are working the best and move in that direction. So that's where I see us going in 2018. It's just continuously evolving and growing.
So Factor Trust, obviously being part of TransUnion, TransUnion's alternative data product is part of their Credit Vision Link solution. So I encourage you guys to look at Credit Vision Link, and we'll be part of that. So our objectives in 2018 is how to take all this big data under the TransUnion suite of products, and that data is the traditional data, the TLO data, the eBureau data, the Factor Trust data, how to combine all that and to provide deliverable solutions to you guys, like I mentioned earlier. Whether that be scores, attributes, credit reports. And so that's obviously a key initiative for us, is to take our big data assets, combine those, and deliver those in the most usable, most performance type products that we can. And the other thing that I'll echo off Jeremiah is the integration. as a data provider, it's critical for us to be integrated into whether it be a collection servicing platform like MasterCue or be front-end loan origination systems. We need to make sure that we're integrated in those platforms so you can have access to the data in the most easy way.
I already touched on originations and collections. I guess one of the areas that I think we can continue to grow in is remarketing. I know some of you, when I was with the banks, would go with our remarketing folks to the auction, and we had just underwritten a loan several months ago to some guidebook which has a regional average. Carfax is in Northern Virginia, so a car and it goes, the territory goes all the way down to Florida in a lot of cases, so a car in Washington, D.C. is valued the same as the one in Tifton, Georgia. It just doesn't make sense. So we have a new product, history-based value, that takes into consideration kind of the same starting point, but then throws in all the vehicle history into that. So if you got its oil changed over 3,000 miles, only had one owner, no accidents, et cetera, et cetera. And it puts all that stuff in together and comes up with a VIN-specific value for a vehicle. And I know going, like I said, with our remarketing guys to auctions, we underwrite some book, and I walk around and saw some dealer friends on the other side, and they're sitting there with a Carfax report to bid on the car. So we're underwriting to something that our ultimate buyers don't care about. So I think that's going to become a valuable tool in helping set floors, taking cars to auction, and valuing what you really think you can get for cars. So I think the remarketing piece is an area we're going to continue to grow.
I think the highest value for what we do is in the originations. By being able to access all that unstructured data, triangulate on different data points, allows you to grow your